Hello, everyone. My name is Juhi Apte, and I'm a member of the steering committee of Green Neighbours Network of Toronto, also known as GNN, and I am one of the volunteers organizing today's wonderful event. Welcome to the historic first member celebration and annual general meeting of Green Neighbours Network of Toronto. It is our first since becoming an incorporated not-for-profit a year ago. We have an awesome program coming up, and we are very thankful to the organizers, the presenters, and the MC who have volunteered to make it happen. And we are thankful to you for joining us. Please feel free to introduce yourself in the chat, perhaps share whereabouts you live in the city, GTA, or beyond, whether you are part of a green group or if you're keen to help start one. Wherever you're from, welcome. We would like to begin by acknowledging and thanking the Indigenous peoples of this land. We are grateful for the opportunity to acknowledge and recognize the enduring presence and resilience of Indigenous peoples and their care for this land since time immemorial. This event today is hosted from the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. It is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. We also acknowledge that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. We invite all participants to reflect on how we are all accountable to these relationships. And now, I would like to turn things over to another enthusiastic GNN volunteer on the organizing team, Brittany Mifsud. Brittany will be our MC for today. So Brittany signed up on the GNN website about 3 months ago and ticked yes in the interested in volunteering box. And in the tell us more section, Brittany said, "I truly believe that fostering community and connection to one another and to our planet is the way we can change our habits and work towards a greener and more sustainable planet." We went, whoa. We knew instantly that she'd be a great fit for GNN. Within weeks, she became an integral part of today's planning team and a huge help, and is today's MC. Take it away, Brittany.
Thank you, Juhi. Hi, everybody. I'm so excited to be here to MC today's GNN member celebration event and to celebrate GNN's first year as a registered not-for-profit. This is a historic moment for GNN, so I'm so happy to be here to share it with all of you. To start off, I'd like to let you know that this event is being recorded, so it will be available on the GNN YouTube channel soon. And we're very grateful that you're joining us today, and we really look forward to your participation in the event. So what I mean by participation is please be active in the chat, leave any questions, comments in the chat as we go. We have two chat moderators, Priscilla and Pedro, who will be collecting the questions so we can use them at the various Q&A throughout the program. So please don't be shy. I'd like to turn things over now to Lee Adamson. She's a member of the organizing committee for today's event, and she's GNN's incoming chair, and she would like to say a few words. So please go ahead, Lee.
Thank you very much, Brittany, and so good to see everyone here today for this exciting event. Thanks for coming. So on this spring, this beautiful spring day, we certainly have a lot to be thankful for. Each other, the spring flowers, the green, the bird song, they fill us with hope for our beautiful living planet Earth. But I would like to begin by giving a voice to the elephant in the room. As we all know, there is also a lot to be anxious about: climate change, biodiversity loss, plastic waste. We must have our carbon emissions this decade for a livable climate. Scientists have told us so. Yet Canada's carbon emissions per person remain among the highest in the world, and they are not falling yet. These are enormous problems, and not something we can or should face alone. The problems are global, but they're local problems too, which means that we can each do something in our own neighborhoods, in our own way, to help turn things around. It is time for all hands on deck. And thankfully, action is the antidote to despair. In fact, this was the big idea that sparked Green Neighbors Network, a way to facilitate and encourage concerned individuals and green groups across Toronto and the GTA to connect so we don't feel so anxious, so alone, and so powerless. We support each other in taking action. Now, even great ideas need foundations. And that's been the big enterprise for this past year. We registered as a not-for-profit last spring, and a few hours ago, we had our first annual general meeting where we passed our bylaws and elected GNN's 2021 Board of Directors. As the founding chair of GNN, Paul Onsa took on the mammoth task of writing and rewriting and finally finalizing GNN's bylaws, thereby creating a sound foundation for GNN to grow and prosper as an organization into the future. We are enormously thankful for Paul's care, thought, and effort, as well as enormously thankful to Grace Bettle, a member of GNN's member group, Parkdale High Park for Climate Action, and a retired lawyer, for her invaluable help and advice. And I believe Grace is here today. So Grace, here's a big thank you for your very gratefully appreciated help. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Paul Onsa to fill you in on where GNN has been and how we got here to today's moment. Thank you. Paul, it's over to you.
Thanks very much, Lee. You know, when Lee asked me to say a few words about where we are and how we got here, my first thought was, gee, we've been at this for quite a long time. When did it begin, actually? Well, I can remember the occasion. It was a blustery day in late November of 2016 when five of us met in the Mezzetta Cafe on St. Clair West to share some Middle Eastern tapas and kick around a few ideas. We'd all been active in local green groups and really enjoyed meeting our neighbors and creating events to build climate awareness and energy savings and so on. But we were frustrated by the limited scope of these activities. Surely we could make more headway by linking up with other groups, sharing ideas, and maybe even incubating new groups in other parts of the city. By the end of lunch, we convinced ourselves to try the idea on a few more friends. There were about a dozen of us at the next meeting, which we held at Lee's house, calling it a party with an agenda. The agenda part brought on a very lively discussion. On the one hand, there was a lot of excitement in the room, enough to convince us that we were onto something. On the other hand, there were some serious doubts about how it could ever work. And I'll have a little more to say about those in a minute. In any case, we all left the meeting wanting somehow to press ahead, but unsure of what to do next, and well aware that it wouldn't be easy. We weren't wrong on that score, but looking back now, I think our little group would have been astonished to see what GNN has become today. The sheer numbers are pretty impressive. Today, our network brings together some 23 local neighborhood groups, 12 citywide grassroots, and 10 partner groups, for a total of 45 member groups in all. And at latest count, GNN also had more than 700 individual members. Now, you might say those numbers tell us more about the growing popularity of grassroots environmental action than they do about our network. So what about GNN? What have we been up to lately? Well, it turns out quite a bit. Just about exactly a year ago, GNN became a federally registered nonprofit corporation. Being incorporated made us eligible for federal grants. And so our volunteer executive director, Colin Love, lost no time in applying for one via the Canada Summer Jobs Program. We used the grant to hire a talented journalist videographer who carried out detailed telephone surveys of our member groups to learn more about their needs and then produced a series of brief promotional videos about them. During this time, we also experimented with a microgrant program to help our member groups to cover some costs of their activities, allowing them to do a little more with less. Important as they were, these projects pale before GNN's biggest event of the year, the first ever virtual Toronto EcoFair, a month-long festival of workshops, webinars, films, and vendor events carried out almost entirely online in October and November. The fair was a resounding success by any measure and a testament to the impressive skills of the organizing team led by Lee Adamson. And then, of course, winding up the year is today's membership celebration, again, the work of another very able team led by Lee and itself, the first of its kind. So all in all, I'd say a pretty busy and productive year and right in the middle of a pandemic. How did we get to this point? Well, the answer is complicated, and it involves contributions by a lot of dedicated people, all of whom deserve to be thanked, except that if I did so, I'm sure I would use up the rest of my time. So instead, I'd like to point to something more general that made a big difference, a kind of slow breakthrough that has been changing the way we operate and what we've been able to get done. Remember those doubts I mentioned about the network idea that came up in our early meetings? Well, in some ways, they were well-founded. We weren't really clear about this, but I think we were hoping that the leaders of our member groups would all somehow chip in a bit of their time and energy, maybe in rotation, to staff our network steering committee. We'd all sort of pool our resources and somehow make it happen. Alas, it never worked out that way. One of the comments we heard at that second meeting expressed the problem very clearly. We love the idea of a green group network, but we're already up to our eyeballs running our own groups. We just don't have any time or energy to spare. Well, we managed to work around this problem for the first year or two by drawing heavily on members who were retired or otherwise had time to spare, but we knew that wasn't a permanent solution. So, what changed? I think the breakthrough came when we realized that there were very able individuals out there, some already members of GNN, others yet to be discovered, who did have a bit of spare time and were excited about the challenges we offered. Late in the fall of 2018, we had put out the first in a series of volunteer job postings in bulletins like Good Work for specific positions on our leadership team. We were amazed by the number and quality of the applications we received. This is the beginning of something new. The process is still ongoing, but we feel very lucky to say that the best of these applicants in a variety of areas now form the core of our very dedicated steering committee. During this time, we also began to appreciate the talents and energy of the many individual GNN members who stepped up to help organize time-limited but intensive projects like our annual EcoFair. We began to realize that while our member groups are the focus of our purpose as an organization, our volunteers are really the backbone of GNN's capacities as a network. To put it differently, we began to recognize that GNN's success hinges on the interplay of two distinct elements. One is a diverse collection of volunteer-led member groups, all working in their own neighborhoods or on their own issues, groups like the ones you'll be meeting here today. The other, equally important, is a strong team of GNN volunteers helping to support, connect, and celebrate these groups and their efforts to make our city a greener place. So, what's the takeaway lesson here? Well, that might depend on who's asking. For those of you who aren't yet part of the GNN network, it means that there are two big ways you can get involved. The first is to join one of our existing member groups, in addition to the ones you'll be meeting today. You can learn about all of the others on our website and decide which is best for you. Or you can start one of your own, and we may be able to help you with that. The second option, the second path, is to begin by becoming an individual member of GNN. It's very easy. Just go to our website and click on join. Signing up will get you a free subscription to our excellent newsletter, by far the best place to learn what GNN is all about. You'll also get a chance to join one of our really interesting and active project teams, political engagement, home energy, zero waste, which all of which depend on the contributions of individual members. Or you can take the final step and become a GNN volunteer. If you have time, even a little time, we have the opportunities. And you can see there are quite a few here in all sorts of areas, and that's not the whole list. So there are plenty of ways to be part of GNN and to make to add something to what we're doing. So think about it. It's a great way to have some fun, meet some cool people, and make a real difference. So with those words and the ringing in the ears of our audience, Brittany, I turn the microphone back to you.
Thank you, Paul. That was awesome. And like Paul was saying, at the heart of GNN and at the heart of all our member groups is the passion and energy of volunteers. And all of the volunteers work tirelessly to make Toronto greener, healthier, and more sustainable every single day. And today, the point of today is that we're here to meet them, to celebrate them, and to thank them for all the hard work that they do. So I'd like to start off by introducing you to some of the fabulous GNN members who work hard behind the scenes to make GNN happen. So we'll meet the steering committee. First off, we have Paul Onsa, the incoming senior advisor. We have Lee Adamson, the incoming chair. Colin Love, the executive director. Zenaida Yi, the incoming co-chair. Tom Daly, the treasurer. Juhi Apte, the social media lead. Allison Pope, who's the zero waste lead. Francesco Manduca, who's the newsletter lead. And Arti Varadarajan, who is the IT lead. So there's your steering committee. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
And now we will meet the GNN newsletter editors, and they work so hard every single month to bring you the latest member news, green events, and calls to action right into your inbox from all across Toronto. So we'll start off by meeting editor-in-chief Francesco Manduca. And we have our zero waste editor, Poppy Burbage. And not here today, we have the Youth in Action editor, Sarah Syed. So there's our newsletter team. Hi, guys. So why do our volunteers work so hard at GNN? It's because we are inspired by and motivated by the energy and passion of all of the people who are part of our almost 50 member groups that are helping to make Toronto greener, healthier, and more sustainable. And so we'll get the celebration of these people off to an exciting start by watching a quick compilation video that was made by our GNN volunteer named Jeff Young. We think this video really captures the energy and the innovation and the variety of our members. And there's truly something to inspire everyone at GNN. So tech team, please play that video now. Awesome. So that's a big thank you to all the member groups who submitted photos, and a huge thank you to Jeff Young for turning them into such an outstanding tribute to all of our awesome GNN member groups. I think that Jeff is joining us today, so thank you so much, Jeff. A standing ovation is due for you. And like we were saying, we have nearly 50 GNN member groups across the city and the GTA, and all of them are doing fabulous, inspiring work, and all of them have a wealth of passion, stories, experiences. So those of us at the planning team are so lucky. It was hard to not want to celebrate every single group today, but that would be a much longer event. So today we're going to hear from five of them. Five of our GNN member leaders will tell us a bit about what they do and how we can learn from them to achieve even more. So that's both personally in our own lives and then collectively as people who are sharing and caring for our beautiful planet. So we'll start off with Dorothy. And Dorothy Windmuller. She co-founded Cliffcrest Butterfly Way in 2020, actually at the beginning of the COVID pandemic. So while many of our member groups were struggling to stay active during the lockdown, Dorothy succeeded in starting a whole new group. So we find that super impressive and we're really excited to hear from you. So please take it away, Dorothy.
Thank you. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you everybody for coming. What a glorious day today. And so my neighbor and I founded our Butterfly Way beginning of 2020 while pulling in the garbage bins. 1.5 years earlier, I had moved to Cliffcrest, and without being informed about the ecological power of native plants, I had replaced a small patch of my all lawn, the typical house you buy, right, yard, with some native plants. Just being baffled by the unbelievable amount of bees, butterflies, and birds these plants brought within the same summer, I became very passionate about creating habitat for wildlife. Putting this in a broader context, the worldwide wildlife population has decreased by 2/3 since 1970 in our lifetime, like in at least my lifetime. Whereas at the same time, livestock now accounts for 60% of biomass of all mammals. And the biomass of the wild animals shrunk to only 4%. So with our current garden practices, we all actively cause further declines of birds and insects. So experiencing how easy it is to bring back a backyard brimming with life, sustaining biodiversity, we felt the urgency to act. Everybody's garden or park is land where every citizen can contribute and make a real difference in the world. Just ignorance and outdated knowledge causes this detrimental and outdated behavior. So now what did we do? COVID has hit and we wanted to get as many people as possible to add native plants to their yards. So now how do I move this here? So in March, we launched our website and open Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts. I will illustrate our story with Facebook, an extremely powerful tool to connect with like-minded people. To get the word out, we posted on all general Facebook groups in our area. And then we felt we needed some more, you know, local advertisement. And so we made this really homemade signs and put them in all sorts of neighbors' gardens on big streets. And we also had a newspaper article in a local newspaper, and we got invited to Here and Now at CBC to talk with our neighboring Birchcliff Butterfly Way. And it is surprisingly easy to get covered by me. We realized very quickly that our team is not only our volunteers. A team consists of all the mentors, other groups, and leaders working on the same issues. Connecting and fostering relationships and partnerships and working together can really elevate your efforts. We offered then free seeds and later free seedlings, which we had all grown ourselves, still posting in the neighborhood Facebook groups to get the word out. There, we encourage people to join our Facebook group then, and to get free plans and grow our members. We met with about 120 people safely in our gardens, giving out about 1,000 native free plans, and we got to know a lot of people. We also worked with schools and had a fall plant sale. We were a committed group of 6 volunteers. In fall, we gave out 50 free shrubs from your leaf and seed trays to sitters with the David Suzuki Foundation. Every single interaction with the public, we grow our core volunteer group and followers.
Hey, Dorothy, I think the papers on your laptop are ruffling and making an additional sound.
Oh, sorry. Okay. No worries.
Thanks.
So wait a second. Now where we are. So during the winter, our diverse and talented group of volunteers became the most active. We were poised to spark the fire in the community and get people growing native plants from seed, to have abundant plants available in the neighborhood for giveaways, schools, and community projects this year. So we used the collected emails and phone numbers, as well as our growing social media presence, to invite for a webinar. And I think this is this one, on how to grow native plants from seed. And we had 85 people who signed up for our first webinar. And then we made a couple more. So this created an amazing group of 50 people growing native plants from our own seed to share with the community this year. This spring, we hosted a virtual native plant sale for Cliffcrest and posted it on Facebook. We got about 170 people adding over 2,500 plants to their gardens. Having the posts shared really magnifies effort. And here again come all the great groups, mentors, and supporters into play. We have seen that action is the key to creating movement with snowball effect. That's why I encourage you to dream big and act now. So the goal of all our group is to create change. We believe the best way to get us to change our behaviors is to wake up our blood memory, as Indigenous elders would call it. We believe that through education, we will get lasting change of our mindset, which will automatically lead to change of our behavior. So coming full circle, we made signs again for front yards to reach people who are not on social media and who are not per se interested in our topic. We hope to get the message out to people who have never thought that the garden could be a powerful tool to restore and heal our world. And so these signs will be available through the website. Thank you very much. And sorry for the rushing.
Thank you so much, Dorothy. Next up, we have Saba Khan. She is the co-founder of Enviro Muslims, which is a community group based in Mississauga. And she will be talking about starting right where you are with your community to encourage and empower people and to promote sustainability. So please take it away, Saba.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. Thanks, Brittany, for that introduction. I'm from Enviro Muslims, and I'm very excited to be here with you this afternoon. We are one of the newer members of GNN, and it's just always fantastic to connect with like-minded folks. So just a little bit about Enviro Muslims. We started as a group in November of 2019, so just a few months before COVID really turned things upside down. And our goal is to engage with, educate, and truly empower Canadian Muslims to embed sustainability where they live, work, play, and pray, which is something that we truly believe is an integral part of our religion. And we do this in kind of two main ways. We provide educational tools, resources, and events, both in person before COVID and now virtually, to provide Canadian Muslims with knowledge around how they can build a sense of love to care for the natural environment. And we also celebrate the diverse voices of Canadian Muslims, as well as their contributions to this space. So these are just a couple of our campaigns that we've had going on. We do urban gardening and other workshops with Muslim youth through our mosques and community centers. We have a monthly book club, which is called the People Planet Pages Book Club. We've done a few campaigns during Ramadan. Just this past month, we did one centered around the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And we have other campaigns, like we do Instagram live sessions and give access to Muslims across the country to our Instagram account so that we can help get the word out about the work that they do and their commitment to sustainability. So today I wanted to highlight two of the projects that we're working on that we're very proud of. The first is the Greening Canadian Mosques program. And it's a program in partnership with our friends at Faith in the Common Good and with funding from Olive Tree Foundation. And it consists of two parts. It's a toolkit and a communications package. So it provides Canadian mosque management teams and our imams with the tools, resources, and action plans that they need to embed sustainable practices within their facilities, as well as engage with the communities around their mosques as well. In the Muslim community, sustainability hasn't really been a popular topic, and that's one of the motivating factors as to why Enviro Muslims came to be. So we have this program, which we're really proud of. And one of the highlights of this is really our communications package, which I love so much because it really speaks to the diversity of the Muslim population in Canada. We have multilingual posters that really promote inclusivity. We have action plans related to things like water stewardship, waste management. And it really drives home the fact that Islam really promotes us to be stewards of the environment. And we have a responsibility to care for our shared home. And if you'd like to learn more about this program, you can visit the Faith in the Common Good website. And the second program I wanted to highlight is called Our Climate, Our Stories, which is a digital ebook created as part of an initiative of our People Planet Pages book club. So it's in partnership with the Community Climate Council, the Books Art Music Collective, and Climate Illustrated. And it's an ebook that consists of 20 stories, short stories, essays, and poems by Canadian BIPOC youth really across the country. And it explores their lived experiences related to the impacts of climate change. It's a beautiful book. It's available for download on our website. And a lot of the stories also have illustrations associated with them from artists really across the globe. So I encourage you to please download it. And it really speaks to the importance of not only giving youth a space to share their lived experiences, but also the understanding that diverse communities have so much to offer in this space, whether you're looking at it from a faith perspective or a cultural perspective. There's just so much we can learn from each other. And finally, just to wrap things up, I wanted to just share something that I heard at an event that the Toronto Public Library had hosted a few months ago. And hopefully we can share the link to that in the chat. But Jacqueline L. Scott, who is a PhD student at the University of Toronto, posed this question to the audience, and it really resonated with me. And it's something that I wanted to share with the GNN community. And she asked, does your organization pass the subway test? And that really resonated with me, especially in our group, because we're all based either in Toronto or the Greater Toronto Area, and our home is known for diversity. And one thing that we really need to do, and this is a reminder for Enviro Muslims first and foremost, is to take a look at the community we serve and our organization. And asking if it passes the subway test just means when you get onto a Toronto subway and you look around and you see the people from diverse backgrounds, from diverse and different faiths, does your organization reflect that? And if it doesn't, what can you do to make sure that you're putting in the work to make sure that it does? So I just like to leave it at that. And thank you so much for your time. And I look forward to connecting with everyone in the networking session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Saba. Next up is Beth Zerpicki. And Beth is the founder of Cabbage Town Reduces, and she's going to tell us a bit about the Reduces movement. This movement began in 2019 as Raunty Reduces because it was out of the Toronto neighborhood Roncevales. And in just 2 short years, it has expanded across the province and across the country, and it's now known as Canada Reduces. So we're very inspired by how quickly change can happen, and we're excited to hear you, Beth.
Thank you much. Let me just get going here. Can you all see that okay? Yes. Okay. Thanks for having me here to talk about Canada Reduces, which is a network of local groups formed by neighbors with a collective mission to reduce plastic and packaging waste by inspiring neighbors and neighborhood businesses to work together. You may have seen in the video earlier that a number of Reduces groups are GNN members. And the primary element of our network is the sticker. You can see one version of the sticker here, which encourages bring your own or BYO habits for shopping and to lower barriers to waste reduction for communities. So how does it work? Three very simple steps. Individuals interested in waste reduction are encouraged to start by talking to their neighbors and find a couple other people who are interested in it too. Once a group is formed, they arm themselves with the sticker, like we saw on the last slide, to canvas businesses, asking if customers could be allowed to BYO. Depending on the shop, what customers would be BYO could change. So takeout containers for restaurants or butcher shops or delis or cloth bags for bulk shopping, etc. The list goes on. And if the business agrees, they place a sticker, usually in the front window of their shop, to signal to their customers that BYO habits are welcome. And then the group promotes that business on social media. And the third and most important step, which is ongoing, is to spread the word. So groups let their neighbors know about the opportunity to reduce waste through BYO in various ways, community-wide flyers, hosting events, tabling at neighborhood festivals, etc. The scale and the style of the outreach really depends on the group itself. Let's see. Oh, yep. Okay. So this is Tina Soldevieri. Canada Reduces began in January 2019 in the Roncesvalles neighborhood when Tina reached out to her neighbors to see if anyone wanted to help reduce waste with an environmental education project. She emailed a few people she thought may be interested. They forwarded on to a couple more, and the group was formed. They canvassed businesses to ask for BYO permission, and voila, Reduces was born. So how did it grow? The Reduces movement spread very organically as people in other neighborhoods came across it and were inspired. Tina offered support, shared tools that Raunty Reduces had created, helped them get a sticker, and shared the learnings of their group to help groups get moving. And I asked Tina about when that first person asked her to sort of replicate what she had done with her group. And I said that I could imagine that a couple of people in her position might feel some ownership over what they had built and may want to control how other groups roll it out. And she said, she gave me a lovely answer, which I'll paraphrase here. With sustainability, she feels that you shouldn't be attached to what you create because you want it to spread, and that we shouldn't put limitations on environmental initiatives. And I personally think that one of the many reasons we're lucky that Tina started this is because she has that mentality. And so by May of 2019, six more groups had reached out and started to form. And then by March of 2020, within just about a year, there were 20 groups. And this is some maps of the coverage area. We're in seven different cities. And we have 14 groups in Toronto, and those are our stickers on the bottom right. And so one of the things that I wanted to share today is that as we've grown, it seems very normal and feels very normal that expectations would pop up about procedure, and that we would, over time, we've had discussions about whether we should establish network-wide policies. For example, what does a business have to do to qualify for a sticker? And in the end, what this was about was choosing to allow the network to stay decentralized and for groups to keep complete and total control and autonomy over their own work or not. And in making those decisions, we had to think about how they would impact the elements that have allowed reduces to inspire and spread so well and so quickly. And those elements are ease of replicability. We have a very, very low barrier to entry, which is essentially none. Each group is able to make this work their own. We know that pride and excitement is stronger, right, when you feel ownership over what you're doing and when you're leading something, and that that can have ripple effects down the line. We have a localized focus. Each group can lean into the unique character and assets of their own neighborhood and focus on activities relative to their own community. And flexibility. Groups can do whatever they are most passionate about and make it fit into their existing activities and lives and schedules, however works for them. There's no like set amount of time you have to commit or benchmarks you must hit. What this is really about is striking a balance to empower or let go. Pollution problem, advocated for better policies, and become a network of people across Toronto that have been able to connect and support each other. And I'll just wrap there. We have a new website, CanadaReduces.ca, where you can find if there's a neighborhood in your group. There's lots of other fun like waste reduction resources and also tips for how to start a group if you're interested. Thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you, Beth. I think we had a little bit of an audio issue at the end, so maybe in the question and answer, it was just like 10 seconds where it went out. So maybe when we get to the Q&A, we can reiterate what you said. But sure. I just want to share some regrets that the final speaker on our program, Carrie Tai from Neighbors for the Planet in Richmond Hill, is unable to join us as a speaker today. But we're really hoping she'll join us another time because we'd love to hear more about her story. It's very inspiring. Her group started in 2019 when her and a team in Richmond Hill brought together a diverse group of concerned Canadians to help tackle the climate crisis. And now just 2 years later, they became a legally registered not-for-profit and were awarded the Richmond Hill 2021 Community Organization of the Year. So this was a really big success story that we look forward to hearing more about hopefully soon so we can celebrate with Carrie another time. But in case you want to check out that website, they will link it in the chat. And now we will move on to the Q&A. So if you haven't already put questions in the chat, please do so now and we will get some things rolling. Presenters, if you can turn on your videos and get ready for the first question. So I will start by asking Saba. Saba, how do you centralize your work across communities throughout the city? Geographically speaking, how do you get people to come together?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I guess because we started in November of 2019, we only had about 3 months before COVID really did what it did. And we've all been at home and it's been hard to have those in-person connections. But I think the Green Canadian Moss Program is a great resource for us, not only because it gives us the opportunity to provide these tools and resources to mosques across the country, but it gives them the tools to then engage with their communities through kind of events and recommendations of our team. And we've also been lucky because we're in a virtual setting, we've been able to hold events and have initiatives and different projects that have brought in people from across the country. So we have champions from really different provinces that we've created great bonds with. That's been really helpful. And all of our contests that we do, like for example, last Eid was our first Eid in COVID, which, you know, Eid marks the end of Ramadan. And it's usually just a beautiful time for us all to get together in our communities. And what we did is we held a virtual photo contest where we encourage people to spend time in nature, and we received entries from across the country. And I think the virtual setting has helped us build those connections. But you know, as we are growing, we are looking to create, you know, we're working on building relationships with different groups. We're looking into different grants so that we're able to have projects outside of Mississauga. We have a great relationship with the city of Mississauga. We're looking into different grants so that we can have projects in Toronto as well. So it's a process, but it's something we're very excited about. And our work, again, our goal isn't just to kind of engage with the Muslim population within the GTA. It's really a huge goal in that we want to engage with Muslims across the country. So it's a work in progress, but we're very excited about it and we're working towards that.
Awesome. So next question is for Dorothy. How can we encourage families, so kids, elders, parents, in addition to individuals, to become part of a movement like yours? You're muted, Dorothy.
Is the question about creating their own butterfly way or just to become part of a butterfly way?
Just to become part, I think. More than individuals, how do we encourage everyone to be part of it?
Yes, that's the very big question we pose us every day. So we really think going through schools is certainly very good, which also was very problematic since, you know, the last 2 years through COVID. But I guess when you go into the school, you can really, really show the children how much of an impact a butterfly garden can have on nature, and bring back the butterflies, bring back the bees, and as well the birds. And if they learn about it, also garden practices like leave some of the leaves, don't cut the stems right away because they're seed for the birds. And children are very, very excited about those information, and they bring it back to their parents. And I think this is a really good way to actually reach people who are not really interested in something like this by themselves, right, through the children. So that's what we definitely want to do. And then, as I said, we do the garden science that people walk by, and then with just tidbits of information on there, where they then start to have to see, yeah, actually what I do has a big impact on the environment. I can make a difference, because we always feel so like kind of, can we even make a difference? But no, we can. Everybody can make so many improvements in behavior, which do make a huge difference if we all do it together, right?
For sure. Awesome, thank you. So next, Beth, I have to admit that I was writing questions for you during your presentation, so I'm gonna use one of my questions first. So I guess I can kind of do both of these in one question. So for me, I found, especially during COVID, businesses are very hesitant to let you do bring your own. So in general, I was wondering if you have suggestions for what people can do or say to a business who's resistant to allowing BYO practices, and then especially now during COVID, if there's more that we can say.
Mm-hmm. Great question, and a challenging one for sure. I think especially because right now we want to be doing as much as we can to support local businesses. It feels like a particularly sensitive topic to be trying to encourage them to do something they're not comfortable with. I think that's one of the reasons that when we made this website in March, we dedicated a page to the health and safety of reusables. So I think obviously being very polite and understanding that someone is not interested in doing it, but potentially pointing them to that fact or to that page, or you could always carry a little like handout with you if you wanted to print. There's some expert statements from professionals in there. I would say my personal stance is to not really try and force it, certainly right now, but to open up the conversation just so that they can then on their own time maybe give it some thought or go look at those resources to maybe make their own decision about it. Some of the other groups might have slightly different strategies. Like I said, we all do kind of work independently. And I would say we did just create a little flyer for all the groups to use that outlines the health and safety of reusables. So we are thinking about now, as things are hopefully starting to get a little bit better, or there's sort of an end of COVID in sight, that we could start having more of those conversations so that potentially while some uncertainty lingers about reusables, we can start kind of encouraging people towards it. So maybe not the best answer, but I find especially right now that that's pretty challenging.
Yeah, for sure. And I agree, you can't force the issue. So
yeah.
Okay, so I think unfortunately we're already out of time for the Q&A. So just a reminder to everyone that there will be an opportunity to speak with your speakers at the end of the program. We're going to have breakout rooms. So if your question didn't get asked, you can maybe stick around and ask it later. And now, thank you guys for your awesome answers. And thank you to everyone who asked questions. Now we are delighted to present two citywide grassroots groups who are both in the midst of very ambitious campaigns. So we'll have time for a few questions for each of these speakers as well. So continue to ask questions in the chat. And we'll get started with Myrtle Malaris. She is the co-founder of Climate Pledge Collective, which is an organization that proves to us how powerful a small group of committed people can be. And Myrtle will tell us about their bank switch campaign and how we can help stop big Canadian banks from fueling the climate crisis. So please take it away, Myrtle. You're on mute, Myrtle.
Thank you. So I am Myrtle Moriarez, one of the two co-founders of Climate Pledge Collective, the other being Matthew Lee Pelkey. So we founded Climate Pledge in 2018. So Bank Switch is our most current and the longest running campaign so far. So Bank Switch is basically about getting everyday people like you and me to contact financial advisors at the top five Canadian banks and just let them know that we are unhappy with their current fossil fuel funding policies. And so we provide tools like email templates, letter writing information you could use, and talking points if you'd like to contact your branches. So people have joined BankSwitch. Over 400 people have committed to doing this. So, I mean, it seems like a small number, but really this is more than just a petition over in a couple clicks and then you get updates. Like people are actually communicating with our financial advisors and asking some difficult questions and even escalating that further up the communication chain to get responses. And so for me, this is really important because so banks are obviously fueling the climate crisis with their funding, but in the process, they're also destroying ecosystems, communities, and violating Indigenous rights and human rights. Not just here, but across the globe. So for me, that's an important thing to consider. One of the great things is that people and groups and individuals have amplified the bank switch message. So I'll share three photos here. So on January 29th, there was a big day of action. And here you see Toronto 350's contribution to this. They did a glorious banner drop over the Gardiner first thing in the morning. And they put up eviction notices downtown at the big five Canadian banks. So a very noticeable visual reminder of what's happening. But this day of action really just came about from Matt speaking at a 4-hour kids online event. And Brianne White, who heads up Toronto's 4-hour kids chapter, really wanted to do something, some kind of action. And so as conversation began around this planning across Canada, individuals and groups started to take it and make it their own. So this is just an example of what happened in Toronto, but people in Ottawa, Quebec, and BC, they took part as well. And then if you look to the right, I'll go to the right first. March 19 was the Global Climate Strike Day, and youth activists from Fridays for Future Toronto shut down Bay Street. So this event was covered by the National Observer and Bank Switch was one of the campaigns that they talked about. So again, it's great that this message gets spread. And finally, the middle picture was taken on April 1st. So this was the morning of the TD AGM, and youth from Fridays for Future Toronto in solidarity with Climate Strike Canada and the Divest Canada Coalition launched Banking on a Better Future. So this is a youth pledge where they are basically saying there's no way we are opening an account with an institution that continues to fund the climate crisis and continues to violate Indigenous and just human rights, generally speaking. So that is accessible on our BankSwitch page on our website, if you're interested. So again, you know, Matt and I are basically the two people coming up with campaigns. So it's so great to have other people and groups involved. We certainly couldn't do this work without everybody. So we had originally hoped that BankSwitch, you know, that people who signed up for BankSwitch would move their bank accounts if they don't hear promising changes with regard to banks' fossil fuel lending policies. So April, the Earth Day has now passed. And so what we're doing now is relaunching it. And so this iteration of BankSwitch has launched with podcasts and radio ads, and you'll hear two today. Here we go. This one that you'll hear is now on Classical 96.3 FM.
It's great to see young people taking a stand against climate change. Good thing it's under control.
Actually, it's not. Canadians are among the largest greenhouse gas emitters, so we all need to step up.
What can I do?
Start with your banking. In the last 5 years, the big five Canadian banks have pumped over $600 billion into fossil fuels projects, which endanger marginalized communities.
That's awful. How can I help?
Sign up for BankSwitch. Call your bank and tell the branch manager you're looking for a cleaner bank. Find out more at climatepledgecollective.org/BankSwitch.
And this next is running on podcasts, but we will also be airing it on the same radio station.
Dear adults, I'm already fighting for a sustainable future and I don't even have a bank account yet. I recently learned that the big five Canadian banks are using everyday people's money to support the exact fossil fuel companies that are destroying the lives of marginalized communities and the planet itself. I couldn't be a part of it, so I'll be opening my first account with a local credit union and I'm asking you to switch banks too. We're all working to fight climate change. Why shouldn't our money do the same? Join us and learn more at climatepledgecollective.org/bankswitch.
So obviously the banks haven't really changed much. All of them, I think, are now promising net zero 2050, which we know is too late. So we are hoping with this campaign to continue to spread the word and to push for action. So we certainly couldn't do this work without the incredible supporters that we have. And we benefited from a GNN micro grant this year. We have regular donors or project fund, if you're interested in helping out with that, that is ongoing. And we have so many crowdfunding contributors too that have given to this project and volunteers. Like we have youth voices from Climate Strike Canada, Fridays for Future Toronto on our ads, and someone from Artists for Real Climate Action. And just the people that amplify the message. We're really grateful for that. We couldn't do this work without you. So I have some links that you can access to participate, and hopefully you'll sign up for BankSwitch, this next iteration that hopefully will move accounts the next Earth Day. Thanks so much.
Awesome, thank you, Myrtle. Next up, we have Colleen Lynch, and Colleen Lynch is a passionate member of Climate Fast and leads their exciting Kitchen Table Climate Conversations program. So Colleen will tell us a little bit about how the program works and how it seeks to inspire and mobilize climate concerned individuals, as well as how you can get involved by helping host a conversation among the people that you know. So please take it away, Colleen.
Thank you, Brittany. I'm just going to try sharing my screen here. Yes, thank you to all the other speakers before me. It's so inspiring to hear everything you're doing and the success you're having. So I'm here to talk about what a Kitchen Table Climate Conversation is and how it originated. Well, it did actually start around a table. I remember a round table, which is the best kind of table sometimes for this kind of discussion. And we asked the question about how difficult, why is it so difficult to talk about the climate? And we decided we wanted to create a somewhat structured program and resources to help empower people to talk about the climate emergency and climate justice. So what does our program look like? This also kind of developed as we confronted different challenges. We asked ourselves, what can we do to face this crisis and create the change required? And we thought talking about it is a good start, and creating a compassionate space for one another to share experiences, feelings, and explore ideas together was something that we really wanted to help facilitate. So the first part of the conversation does involve acknowledging the urgency that we are in and the crisis that we face. And this can look like a number of different things for different groups. If it's a group that's not that aware, it can look like some science. If it's a group that has a specific area that they're interested in, like maybe food, It can be food justice or food security. And it can be really, really well led by the participants themselves. I was in a really good conversation recently where they shared the experiences of the climate impacts from their home country around the circle. And that was really impactful. So the next challenge, though, is after the urgency, how do we balance the fear with hope and moving into collective action together? So the way we do that is we spend just a little time on the urgency and we move very quickly into allowing people to talk about their feelings and to imagine what a better future might look like. And that takes us into also talking about solutions and potential actions. So what the last part of the conversation is important to leave people feeling like they can do something. And that can be an individual action. We've seen many ideas today. They could be working collectively, joining a group and working with one of the three neighbors groups. And it could be like we have three elections coming up in the near future. So it could be working to raise awareness politically around the importance of candidates who will work for a livable future for all. So there's multiple things that a conversation could lead to. So we had another challenge. Of course, we had COVID start and we could no longer meet around those round tables and in person. So we worked really hard over the past year to help people who want to tailor conversations for different groups, who want to host or facilitate a conversation. This is a screenshot from our new website, climateconversations.ca, and the resources there, and you can fill out a form to ask for support. We also have monthly support meetings ongoing, and we have just done 4 webcasts for hosts and facilitators. And that's what I want to end with. It's just, I get so excited thinking about all of the experiences and ideas that were shared at those webcasts from everyone who has ideas about where they would like to hold a conversation. And this picture is from a teach-in we had. And in this picture alone, we have at least 3 people who are running faith-based conversations. We have a couple who are running conversations through Africa Climate Action Initiative. And I don't want to embarrass her, but Valerie, you see in the second row there, she is bringing in new volunteers and helping them run their conversations, maybe with their family or their coworkers or their neighbors. And I just want to end by an example of 2 conversations I've helped with just to show you how different they can be and the access points that you can have. One was a lunch hour, actually 30 minutes, and a colleague of mine was putting on a lunch hour talk. And so we created a climate game. So we generated a conversation with climate questions, and that's how her coworkers had not even thought about recycling yet. So it was a very soft entrance. And then it is helpful to have a buddy that you trust to help you so you feel that you can run your conversation. And so I want to tell a very personal story. My first conversation, my first big conversation was with my mother in my rural hometown where I grew up. So that conversation was in contrast. It went for over 3 hours. It was amazing. And we talked more about the challenges and the opportunities in a rural setting. So I'm going to end there. And you've got some links in the chat. If you have an idea or a group that you think would be great to have a conversation with, please do reach out. We are always excited to help people. I feel more empowered to talk about the climate crisis and climate justice.
Thank you, Colleen. Now we have some time for questions for both Colleen and Myrtle. So we'll get you both up here. And I will start by asking Colleen, this is actually another question that I asked during your presentation, but how do you handle encounters with people who refuse to acknowledge the climate crisis? I have a couple family members that are more, you know, like don't believe in it. And I have a hard time even wanting to get them to even want to engage in that kind of conversation.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a few answers for that. It's really difficult if they're close to you, like it is your family. So that can be really frustrating. But in general, if you have the real climate denier, that will take a lot of energy. And it may be better to concentrate on people that are aware, but not sure how they can act or not sure how bad it is and how important it is to act. But with your family, I've had really good advice. I had really good advice from a woman I was in a circle with at Queen's Park, and it was an Indigenous encampment. And what we were talking about was how hard it was to discuss with people who were, you know, and the advice that was given to me was just, you don't want to be antagonize the people you're close to, like you have to live with them. But if you can even just plant a seed of information or a seed of something you're excited with about, or you just learned, or, you know, and every time just one more and one more. My dad, ultra conservative, he is now, he just bought an electric car and he's reading books about the climate crisis and telling me about it. So, I mean, it's hard, but just, you know, and also be kind to yourself. Kind to yourself. You can't do it all at once.
For sure. Thank you. Awesome. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's see. So for Myrtle, okay. I'm going to ask you two questions because one of them is quick. One of them is, where do you find your information on the bank's actions? Do you have that on your website?
On actions? Oh, on the bank's actions. Yeah. So we have some summaries available about like how much each bank has put into fossil fuel projects. But also BankTrack is a great one. So they list banks, not just here, but all over the world. And you can see not just fossil fuel stuff, but anything that's kind of shady, they have details on it, when it happened, et cetera. So I'd say that's probably the number one if you want to check something out.
Awesome. And next question. So fighting the big guns, I'm assuming there isn't always the most supportive environment. So how do you keep going?
Well, they don't like to talk to us, so we don't really necessarily have to talk to them too much. It's definitely hard. You kind of find ways to let go of tears sometimes, just as I do with any sort of climate crisis issue. And just knowing how many people are getting involved, I think that really helps so that it's not just us. And, you know, it's mostly me and Matt. We haven't been able to really gather a group of volunteers right now, like consistently to help us out. And so, but just knowing that people are jumping in from all over, like we get emails asking questions, emails that there's like a letter writing workshop happening. Like, it's just so great. And knowing that is really helpful and definitely helps us keep going.
And I'm assuming you guys have looked into the credit unions that are clean, obviously.
Yeah, so there are some bigger local ones in Toronto. So like there's Meridian and Alterna Savings, for example. But, you know, there are so many local credit unions. I'd say look for one that has values that you share and your money is secured through CDIC, so they are insured. So look for that on their websites and just see which one seems like it's going to work for you. So Desjardins is a big one, but they're not entirely clean. They have a green fund currently. So you do want to still ask questions like, do you have a policy around lending? So what does that look like? If there are other ethical issues you'd like to learn about, then you should ask them that too. So definitely smaller is better because they're not going to be lending a lot of money. They're not going to be, companies aren't going to be going to smaller banks or credit unions for that funding necessarily. So already it's a good thing to start looking at.
Okay, awesome. And Colleen, how do we get involved with you? Are you currently looking for volunteers to host?
Sure, yes. We have the website. You can fill out the contact form, or you can actually just email katcc@climatestaff.ca. We have a team, a small team that would be great to grow.
Awesome. And Juhi is wondering, how did you get your dad to turn the green page?
Yeah, you know what? After I said that, I wondered if my dad watches this. My dad, he's a big conversationalist. So it was a lot of just listening and being respectful and saying what I'm doing, what I'm learning, you know, and allowing some of the resistance to come up, allowing some, you know, and just sort of saying, yeah, you know, I can understand why you're afraid of that, or I can understand why you feel that way. And, you know, but this is why I feel this way, you know, and just so the dialogue, not giving up completely around the supper table, but when it got to be too much, just saying, okay, we're gonna play a game now, you know, it's the same time, or, you know, that type of thing. Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Thank you guys so much. And thank you to everyone who submitted questions. We are now nearing the end of our program for today. So I would like to invite Colin Love, who is GNN's Volunteer Executive Director. He will give us a glimpse of GNN's plans for the upcoming year. So please go ahead, Colin.
Thanks so much, Brittany. My name is Colin pleased to say I've been a volunteer with GNN since 2018, and it's been the genuine real privilege to be the acting or act as the executive director for GNN for the last year or so. So we've heard a lot today, obviously mostly from our members, which is great because that's who GNN is. We are our members. We heard a bit from Paul and Lee to get things going in terms of where GNN's come from, as well as, you know, where we are right now. So I've been asked to share a little bit about, well, where are we going? What's the future of GNN look like? But before I do, in stepping back, could we just all, like, you know, acknowledge here how incredibly pro this entire event has been? You know, it's funny, it's scripted down to the minute. So I think Zenaida, we're about 3 minutes and 23 seconds late. So I'll try to condense mine. But again, I just a huge thank you to the entire planning team who helped to put this event together. They've been working tirelessly every week, meeting to help pull this off. And this is Zenaida, Juhi, who you've met, as well as Brittany, our fantastic MC. We also have Artie, who you'll hear from shortly. And of course, last but certainly not least, Lee, as the incredible eco champion she is. And obviously, thank you to all our speakers as well for helping make this such a, you know, an incredible member celebration by hearing your stories and your inspiration. Should also give a quick shout out. There's an incredible behind the scenes tech team, as you've heard of, who are just doing an incredible job today. And their leader, Elena, again, she was, again, critical as well in terms of all the great EcoFair virtual activities from back in, you know, back in the fall. So again, thank you to Elena and all the tech team. Yeah, as well as all the speakers. It's funny, I don't think I'm the only one who's probably noticing this, that like every single name I just thanked, all women, all the women speakers today. So certainly, ladies, you're making the world a better place and leading the way. With that being said, though, a special thank you to Paul A. I mean, and Paul A started this off, and we know, you know, he's the outgoing chair, but again, Paul's passion and leadership through the entire GNN, history from 2016 to where we are today. And Paul, what an incredible legacy in terms of these flawless, bulletproof bylaws that you and Grace have put on. So thank you, Paul, as well. But yeah, well, let's get into it. You know, really briefly, in terms of where GNN is going, it's funny because I think I was thinking about how to answer this, and I thought one way might be to also circle back to a question, at least the question I hear more than anything else, the other question since being involved with GNN in the early days as well. What is GNN, and what do we do, or what does GNN do? And I think, to be honest, the answer to this question is really three words. And it is, you know, can be found actually in GNN's brand new vision statement of purpose, mission statement, but without any particular order, three words: celebration, support, and connecting. Okay, and celebration, we're all here today celebrating our incredible member groups. And I'm sure I'm not the only one who noticed that this is actually the first annual member celebration. So please stay tuned for same bat time, same bat place next year, hopefully in person, as well as EcoFair. I think that's another fantastic opportunity for celebration. Second word there, connecting. And again, this is so key to what GNN's very DNA is all about, connecting. You know, today being a good example, hopefully some networking, same thing with EcoFair. Just wait till we can get back in person again. I think that's really where neighborly interactions shine, as we all know. But again, one of the things we've been thinking a lot about at GNN is how we can sort of really leverage some of the digital technological tools we've been, you know, building off of to really help do the work that GNN has been involved with. So, you know, everything from Airtable is an online database, system software. We're looking, exploring how we might be able to integrate that into our member groups or member use. And then Google G Suite. Again, we've luckily just got our official, you know, G Suite account. And so we're exploring ways we might be able to work with member groups to help facilitate more peer-to-peer sharing via these incredible technological tools. But then last but not least, we talked about celebration, we talked about connecting, but support, okay? And that's really, I think, where GNN really does, you know, the value proposition, what we really want to do as an organization made up of members is how to support each other, whether it's as simple as, you know, the monthly newsletter, which again, an incredible newsletter team puts on every month. The social media promotion opportunities. I think most of the speakers today helped GNN in the pilot of our micro grant, you know, program, which we're looking forward to rolling out. Another exciting, you know, sort of feature for 2021, 2022, or program we're excited about is almost a little bit of a temp agency, which is, you know, based on the fact that, again, this year we've been successful with Canada Summer Jobs. We'll have a few seasonal staff, and we're thinking, but well, how do we help to find meaningful opportunities for our member groups in regards to these staff? So again, these are just some of the things to keep an eye out for, but big picture, you know, GNN, we are our members. So our members are really what are going to be guiding our priorities as an organization. And, you know, if there's one final thought I can leave with would be just the call to action, similar to what Paul mentioned, in that if you're not already a member, either an individual member or a group member of GNN, please consider it. Please spread the word. And again, as Lee mentioned, it was perfect. You know, action is the anecdote, right? I mean, here's what we can all do from a sense of agency. So thank you all, and thanks for joining us today. But back over to you, Brittany.
Thank you, Colin. That was really awesome. Thank you so much. And as he was saying, if you do want to be a volunteer for GNN, it's very easy. You can just do what I did. You just go onto the website, fill out the sign-on form, tick the yes box, and then tell us a little bit more about how and why you'd like to help. So the link will be put in the chat now. And next up is very exciting. We are very pleased to welcome a member of our provincial legislature to say a few words. Merritt Stiles is here, and she represents the riding of Davenport, and she's a member of the Ontario New Democratic Party and the official opposition critic on education. And she's also a longtime community activist. So Merritt, please begin whenever you're ready.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Brittany. Thank you so much. It is fabulous to be here, everyone. And hello, Green Neighbors Network. As was said, I'm Marit Stiles. I'm the member of Provincial Parliament for Davenport, and also the official opposition education critic. And I'm really thrilled to join you today. First of all, I just want to thank all of you, the members, the volunteers, the people that make up the Green Neighbors Network, for your passion, for your efforts, for everything you do to make our city and our province greener, healthier, more sustainable. And of course, the organizers of the event, the Eco Champions, the amazing organizers who made this celebration so lovely. You know, I moved to Toronto about 25 years ago now, and I moved from Newfoundland. I was raised in just outside of St. John's, mostly on sort of little farms with my parents, who were kind of back to the earth people. My parents are both big environmentalists. And it was intimidating to come to Toronto. I won't lie. I remember thinking, I came here to go to university, and I remember thinking, you know, what is all this concrete about? But I very quickly realized that it was a city of neighborhoods. Whether it's, you know, Little Portugal in my riding, or the beaches, or Harbord Village, Riverdale, East York, Agincourt, everything in between. And what I love about Green Neighbors Network is that that focus on the small and local actions that we can all take to make a real difference. And, you know, I sit across from the provincial government every day. And I know sometimes, and I hear this a lot from people, that they feel like the decisions that are being made don't reflect who they are or who we are in our communities, our focus on climate change. But like everything else, and I think this is always so important, it comes from sort of my background too, is that we start local, we organize locally, and that's how all the best things begin. And so I want to thank you again for all that you're doing. And on this really beautiful day, I have to say, I haven't spent much of it outside myself, but I wish I could have, because it's been gorgeous. And it reminds us all, I think, as well, that we are on track to a better tomorrow, to a better day. And that we also remind ourselves not to forget some of the lessons of the pandemic, the importance of investing in strong public services, of public health and well-being, and how critical it is that our communities are strong. and that coming together to make change and help each other out. And thank you, Colin, for summing it up. Celebration, support, connecting. It's so important to take the time to celebrate all the work that's happening, to support each other, and also to connect, which again is at the heart of all the best organizing. And that's, again, truly where all the greatest things begin. I know a lot of people feel like they don't know what they can do to make change right now, but you're doing it. So again, really great to be here. Thank you so much. Such a wonderful opportunity to connect with all of you. And thank you, GNN, and thank you all the members and organizers. Action is the anecdote. So we're doing it. And thank you all, and stay well.
Thank you, Marit. We greatly appreciate you taking the time to join us today, and thank you so much for your inspiring words. And that brings us to near to the end of today's program. So I'd like to ask RT to make the closing remarks. RT is the IT lead on the GNN steering committee, and she's one of the volunteers who helped organize today's event. So please go ahead, RT.
Thanks, Brittany. On behalf of GNN Toronto, I would like to thank each one of you for participating in today's event. The last hour and more has been so interesting and so informative. I hope you all liked it as much as I did. We'd love to hear your feedback. We'd like to have your feedback on how the event went. So we have a quick and easy survey, and the link is shared in the chat. We encourage everyone here today, speakers, audience, volunteers, every one of you to click on the link and fill it out for us. This will help us make our next year's member celebration better. Also, we hope you enjoyed learning about GNN, about our member groups and their campaigns. If you're not already signed up with GNN, then please do. We'd love to have you join us, make connections, make friends, make a difference together. The link to GNN's sign-up page is in the chat right now. Let's all make use of every opportunity to learn, be creative, and take action. Together, we can make this a green new decade in the city. With that, we come to the end of today's program. We encourage you all to stay for the mix and mingle with our GNN volunteers and speakers in breakout rooms. You'll have a chance to have small group discussions and Q&A. But if you have to leave now, kindly take a minute to complete our quick survey. And as I said, it'll help us make next year's event even better. Thank you all so much for coming.
Awesome.